Hello friends, welcome to Smart Catalyst. Today we'll be seeing the current affairs of 11th February 2019. The articles we'll be seeing for prelims are these five. First article talks about the Xinjiang province and the Uyghur Muslims in the country of China. Second article talks about the left-wing extremist areas and the rural road scheme in those areas. The third article talks about the latest government's localization norms for the solar industry and the WTO conflict that may arise in this issue. Fourth article talks about the Bru tribal groups in the states of Mizoram and Tripura. And the final article is about OALP and the help scheme of Petroleum Ministry. The first article we'll be seeing is China's challenge in Xinjiang. This article was taken from the paper Indian Express. So in this article, we have to know about the Uyghur Muslims in the region of Xinjiang in China. So the news here is that nearly 1 million Uyghurs and other Turkic language speaking minorities have been reportedly held in various education camps in China. So in this context, one have to know about the region of Xinjiang, as it may be asked in prelims question. The Xinjiang province is located in western part of China. So it's located here and it is an autonomous province. We also have to know about the countries which border the Xinjiang province. Namely, they are Mongolia, Russia, Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan, Pakistan, a thin strip of Afghanistan, and also Pakistan-occupied Kashmir. It touches Xinjiang province. So who are these Uyghurs? These Uyghurs are ethnically minorities. They are usually Turkish-speaking Muslims who are living in China's Xinjiang province. The problem here is that the Chinese government, it claims that these Xinjiangs in Uyghur province are spreading separatist ideas and following extremism, which is against the unity of the country China. On one hand, the Beijing sources say that the crackdown of the Uyghur Muslims currently happening is in order to protect the unity of the country and to clear the terrorism wing happening there. However, this view has gained widespread criticism among the international community, as it poses serious threat to humanitarian rights, but no international community has come forward to impose sanctions on China. Second article talks about left-wing extremism, the left-wing extremist states and the infrastructure development schemes in those states in order to end the left-wing extremism. So the news here is that only 5% of the total funds which are allocated for making roads in the left-wing extremist areas have properly been implemented. So we all know that there is a central scheme called as Pradhan Mantri Gram Sadak Yojana. So this is implemented by Rural Ministry. So the main aim of this scheme is to provide all weather road connectivity to all eligible unconnected areas in our country. So this centrally sponsored scheme, it provides special focus to tribal as well as left-wing extremist areas. According to recently released the data of implementation of this scheme, out of totally allocated 1000 crore rupees for 11 left-wing affected states including Jharkhand, Maharashtra, Odisha and Telangana, only 5 crore has been properly spent. We all know that tackling left-wing extremism with infrastructure development, job creation and skill development is very much essential for healthy and holistic development of India. So such a lackluster performance in implementation of such infrastructure project will definitely become a roadblock to inclusive development of our country. So this statistic shows the implementation of projects in various left-wing affected areas. Third article talks about Bru families repatriated to Mizoram. This article is about the recent panel's finding on the number of people repatriated to the states of Mizoram and Tripura. So in the year 2018, July, a separate agreement was signed called as Four Corner Agreement. So this agreement is called as Four Corner Agreement because it was signed between the states of Tripura and Mizoram along with the central government plus the Bru tribal leaders. So this agreement, it offered a proper phased repatriation measure for the Bru displaced tribal group in the states of Mizoram as well as Tripura. However, recently released the Parliamentary Standing Committee's report, it has given significant insights on the implementation of this agreement. So according to the report, just 48 out of total 5,400 Bru families are actually repatriated as per the provisions of this agreement. And this agreement also calls for peaceful assimilation of the tribal group in both the states of Tripura as well as Assam. So the Bru tribal group, they are also called as Driang group. They are one of the 21 scheduled tribes according to Indian Constitution. These tribal groups, they are originally present in the states of Mizoram as well as Tripura. However, due to the internal conflict in the year 1997, more tribal groups of Bru community were displaced from the state of Mizoram to Tripura. So now in the state of Tripura, this Bru tribal group are second most popular tribes just after Tripuris. Apart from Tripura, the tribal group is also spread out in other states of Assam and Manipur as well as in the country of Bangladesh. So for the prelims, we can also know about the culture followed by the Bru tribes. The Bru tribes give importance to dance and they regard dance as a very integral part of their lifestyle. So they have a special type of folk dance. The special type of folk dance followed by is called as Hojagiri focal dance. It is not just known for the Bru tribal group, but it is a well-known dance form among the whole world too. The popular festival celebrated among this Riang tribal group is called as Biusu. This is celebrated in the same month as Bihu, which is celebrated in the state of Assam. These tribal groups do not follow dowry system. And the religious affiliation of this Bru tribal group belong to Vaishnav school of Hinduism. And they also claim Kshatriya status in the hierarchy of Hinduism. And these tribal groups, as a part of Vaishnav school of Hinduism, they believe in polytheism, which means that they worship multiple gods and goddesses. These tribal groups speak a language called as Kukborok language of Riang dialect, which has Tibeto-Burmese origin. Next article is that solar industry vary of government's product localization norms. This article was taken from the paper Mint. So the news here is that the Union Cabinet earlier this week, it has agreed a new plan. According to the plan, it will award 12 gigawatts of upcoming grid-connected solar power projects only to the companies which have used locally manufactured cells and modules. This plan will be implemented for 4-year period from 2019 to 2023. The project will also receive viability gap funding of about 8,500 crores. However, the problem here is that the solar industry, they worry about the government rules as the localization norms or local content requirement is against the multilateralism principles of World Trade Organization. So in this context, we know about US-India solar war, which was started in the year 2013. In the year 2013, India brought in local content requirement norms for implementation of Jawaharlal Nehru solar mission. And US has found fault with this India's domestic content requirement program. And United States found fault with this local content requirement program of India as it made local sourcing of parts for projects mandatory. So this is against WTO's norms. The global trade body in the year 2016, it has given a judgment in favor of US and the ruling stating that the Indian rules had favored the local products and it is against WTO standards. Now after 5 years, the government of India has again bought in the same rules. Though these rules on one hand will create more employment, this will definitely go against WTO's norms as again. The final article talks about open acreage licensing system, and the third round of this is now launched by Petroleum Ministry and it is seen to fetch about $700 million as per the estimates. So the center has launched a third round of bids for open acreage licensing program. So we all know that India is third largest energy consumer in the world and we are also a fast growing economy and the energy demand also is growing. About 80% of India's total energy needs is imported from other countries, and in order to make India an energy producing destination and also bring in ease of doing business in the energy sector, the government has brought in large changes in the past couple of years. Among them, first one is implementation of hydrocarbon exploration and licensing policy, which replaced the erstwhile NELP, which is new exploration licensing policy. And the government has also brought in open acreage licensing program along with a national data repository. So here we'll see about these schemes for prelims. So this hydrocarbon exploration policy as against NELP, it covers all conventional as well as unconventional oil and gas. The erstwhile NELP, it did not cover unconventional products such as coal bed methane or shale gas. However, these unconventional sources are also included in the types of hydrocarbon listing under HELP policy. In order to bring in ease of doing business in exploration, a single license will be given under exploration of HELP for all types of oils and gases. However, in pre-HELP era, separate licenses are required for each and every conventional source like oil, gas or coal bed methane. This model also moves to revenue sharing model as against the profit sharing model, in which the government received most of the share of the profits. The most important change brought in under HELP is the coverage area. Under this open acreage policy, every company can apply to explore any block in any part of the country as against the restricted blocks under the previously available bidding system. Here, the companies are also free to sell their production domestically without any government intervention, as no price will be fixed by the government. There's also concession provided for special type of non-conventional sources like ultra deep water areas, which are difficult to explore, and the shallow water areas. And there's also reduction in royalty for shallow water exploited areas. Thank you.